Welcome back here live with Servant of the Lord, Shafronia Castleberry. Today our program will be on why do we put Jesus to an open shame? Praise the Lord. Let's pray now. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we give you glory, praise, and worship and honor. We magnify you and lift you up, Heavenly Father, and we bless your holy name. We thank you for the word of God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray that the word of God be established in heaven as it is on earth, according to your word, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. May God bless all of you listeners out there today. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Bless your holy name. We're going to come from Hebrews 6 chapter, verses 4 through 6. Hebrews, the 6th chapter, verses 4 through 6. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. They were once saved, and the Christians, they were once saved and turned away from God, although they had tasted God's salvation and his works and miracles. They went back into the world, bringing Jesus to an open shame. It's like we re-crucifying him over again, all over again, hammering those 8-inch spikes into his hands and his feet and putting 7-inch thorns into his skull and piercing him with a sword in his side all over again. It pains my heart when I see those who were once Christians re-crucify Jesus afresh. It pains my heart dearly. You see, now today there is a great falling away. An apostasy is what's happening in these days. Luke 10:19-10 says, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost." He come to seek and save that which was lost. But many of those who were saved or who became saved at one time, and they went back into the world, into a great falling away from the faith. We're going to read a little bit more about that now. Let's go to that now. This is called a personal apostasy. Hebrews 3:12 says, "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God." To apostatize means to sever one's saving relationship with Christ or to withdraw from vital union with and true faith in him. Thus, individual apostasy is possible only for those who have first experienced salvation, regeneration, and renewing by the Holy Spirit. It is not a mere denial of New Testament doctrine by the unsaved within the visible church. Apostasy may involve two separate, though related, aspects: theological apostasy, a rejection of all or some of the original teachings of Christ and the apostles. And then there is moral apostasy. The former believer ceased to abide in Christ and instead becomes enslaved again to sin and immorality. The Bible issues urgent warnings concerning the possibility of apostasy, designed both to alert us to the deadly peril of abandoning our union with Christ and to motivate us to persevere in faith and obedience. The divine purpose of these warnings passages must not be weakened by the view that states the warnings are real, but the possibility of actual apostasy is not. Rather, we must see these warnings as speaking to the reality of our probationary period, and we should regard them with sincere alarm if we want to attain final salvation. A few of the many New Testament warnings are Matthew 24, verses 4 through 5, verses 11 through 13. St. John, 15th chapter, verses 1 through 6. Acts 11, verses 21 through 23. Now we're going to go a little further here today. When we read Hebrews 3 and 12, departing from the living God, there are dangers of falling away. There are dangers of falling away. I just read a few of them just now. The Greek term for apostasy is defined as a falling away, defection, withdrawal, or turning from what one has formerly turned to. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter, verses 3 through 4. 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter, verses 3 through 4. Turn with me, please, in your Bible. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. To the Lamb of God. For our exhortation was not of deceit, nor of unclean, nor in guile, but as we were allowed of God to be put in trust with the gospel, even so we speak not as pleasing men, but God, which trieth our hearts. Hallelujah. Your hearts are tried. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Every preacher of the gospel faces the temptation to please men, seek acceptance, approval, and glory from others. By preaching only what will not offend, yielding to this temptation may take the form of tolerating sin and lukewarmness in the congregation. We see that today, saints of God. We see men and women of God preaching the gospel, but they're only preaching to tickle the ears and to please men and women. It may also involve the use of flattering speech in order to gain financial offerings and numerical gain in political office or praise from others. If this occurs, irreparable damage is done to the righteousness and integrity of Christ's church. For this reason, it is essential that our motives in preaching should always be to seek God's approval and not man's. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, glory be to God. Abandonment and rebellion will occur. In the last days, multitudes within the professing church will depart from biblical truth. In the last days, the church will be invaded by godless elements. This falling away in the church will have two dimensions, as I mentioned earlier on. And the first one is theological apostasy and moral apostasy. And the many, love of many, they shall wax cold. Let's go to the Matthew 24 and 12. St. Matthew 24 and 12. And we read that there. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. It said, because of iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. What does it say? It says the love of many shall wax cold because of iniquity shall abound. An unbelievable increase in immorality, shamelessness, rebellion against God, and a casting off of moral restraint will characterize the last days. Sexual perversion, fornication, adultery, pornography, drugs, ungodly music, and lustful entertainment will abound. It will be as the days of Noah, when the very imaginations of human hearts were evil continually. It will be as in the days of Lot, when homosexuality, lesbianism, and all kinds of sexual perversion permeated society. And this is what we see today that's happening around the world. And all you need to do is turn to Jesus, because he is the only way. Hallelujah. Jesus is the way. receive salvation on today. Receive Jesus into your heart because he is the way. He is the way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, let's go to Revelations 2, verses 4 and 5. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Revelations 2, verses 4 and 5. Thank you, Lord. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Many have left their first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. So he must do what? Must repent. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Come back to your first love. Come back to God. Hallelujah. And repent of your sins. This refers to the Ephesians' first deep love for the devotion to Christ and his son. You find that in St. John 14 chapter verses 15 and 21. St. John the 15th chapter verses 10. Pardon. This warning teaches us that knowing correct doctrine, obeying some of the commandments, and worshiping in the church are not enough. The church must have, above all, a heartfelt love for Jesus Christ and all his word. Sincere love for Christ results in single-hearted devotion to him, purity of life, and a love of the truth. Hallelujah. We must have the truth. We must have a love of the truth. Praise God. Christ will reject any congregation or church and remove it from his kingdom if it does not repent of its declining love for and obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you. Oh, glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Bless your holy name. Thank you, Lord. If you left your first love, you must return to your first love before it's too late. You may be asking, how do I do that? And repentance, as we just mentioned, repentance is required to come back to your first love. Repentance. Now let's go to repentance, Acts 3 and 17. Let's go there. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Acts 3 and 17. Bless your holy name. Praise your Jesus. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. We must do what? We must repent, that our sins may be blotted out, and a time of refreshing shall come from the Lord. God has chosen to bless his people with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit only on the conditions of repentance, turning from sin and unrighteousness. Turning from your unrighteous ways of their surrounding perverse generation, and conversion, turning to God, listening to everything that Christ the prophet tells them, and ever moving forward, sincere obedience to Christ. Praise God. Oh, bless your holy name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Throughout this present age and until the return of Christ, God will send times of refreshing, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to all who repent and are converted. Although perilous times will come toward the end of this age and a great falling away from the faith will occur, God still promises to send revival and times of refreshing upon the faithful. The presence of Christ, hallelujah, bless your holy name, and his spiritual blessings and miracles and outpourings of the Holy Spirit will come upon the remnant whose faith fully seek him and overcome the world, the flesh, and dominion of Satan. Praise God. Oh, bless your holy name. Thank you, Jesus, for the word of God. Oh, bless your holy name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless you, Jesus. as I stated early on, about repentance. You must change your lives and repent and come back to God. He will erase your sins, and the times of refreshing, the comfort, shall come with the presence of the Holy Ghost. After you have repented of your sins, ask God for forgiveness of your sins. 1 John 1 and 9. Hallelujah. Go to 1 John 1 and 9. We read there as well. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. It says, I confess my sins to thee, O Lord, to be faithful and just. Forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Oh, bless your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise your holy name, Lord Jesus. We must admit our sins and seek forgiveness and cleansing from God. The two results are forgiveness by and reconciliation with God, and the cleansing, removal of guilt, and the destruction of the power of sin in order to live lives of holiness. Praise God. Oh, bless you, Jesus. Bless you, Jesus. Ask God to remit you of your sins. St. John 20 and 23. Ask God to remit you of your sins. Let's go to that and read that now. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Lamb of God, bless you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. St. John 20 and 23. Precious, precious Jesus. It reads, whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. Pardon. The blood of Jesus cleanses us from sin. Blood of Jesus cleanses us from sin. First John 1 and 7. 1 John 1 and 7. The blood of Jesus cleanses us from sin. Hallelujah. Oh, bless your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. His blood does what? It cleanses us from all sin. Oh, praise the mighty name of Jesus. This means to believe the truth of God as revealed in his word and to make a sincere and sustained effort by his grace to follow it in word and deed. The blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. The blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Refers to the ongoing work of sanctification within the believer and the continual cleansing through the blood of Christ for our inadvertent sins. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your holy name. Bless your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Now, let's go to Romans 10th chapter, verses 9, 10, 11, and 13. Romans the 10th chapter, verses 9, 10, 11, and 13. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For with the heart man believeth unto to righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Hallelujah. Call upon the name of the Lord and ye shall be saved. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Anyone denying the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ cannot legitimately claim to be a Christian. He is still an unbeliever, for the death and resurrection of Christ is the central event in salvation. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And then after you have received salvation, you must be set free from the enemy. have demons cast out if you have any demons. Demons need to be cast out. Receive the baptism of water and the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. Speak in the utterance of tongues. And in Acts 2, 1 through 4. Acts 2, 1 through 4. We go there now. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, glory be to God. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We need to have that fire, the fire power anointing of the Holy Ghost to destroy every yoke of the enemy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And the yokes are destroyed. We read that in Isaiah 10 and 27. Let's go there. Isaiah 10 and 27. Precious Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken away from off thy shoulder, and his yoke from off thy neck. And the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. We need the anointing of God to destroy the yokes of the enemy. Every yoke, every burden, it's destroyed by the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you have that power. You have the power. Hallelujah. And when you're endued with the power of the Holy Ghost, be endued with that power from on high. Let's go to read that scripture, Luke 24 and 49. Hallelujah. Luke 24 and 49. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Being endued with the power is like a cloak, a garment of God's anointing that comes upon you. The promise of my Father that will bring power from on high refers to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that began at Pentecost. Hallelujah. Bless your holy name. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. The disciples waited for this promise in praise to God and devoted prayer. The believer today seeking the baptism in the Holy Spirit should do the same. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Father. Holy Elohim. Thank you. I give you glory, glory. Praise your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We must live an acceptable life unto the Lord, and do not be confounded to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Do not let this world change you. You change the world for God's glory. Once your mind has been renewed, you can discern what God's will is for you. You will know what is pleasing and mature. Hallelujah. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Read those scriptures, please. We must live holy, saints of God. We must live holy at all times. It says, follow peace with all men and holiness without, which no man shall see the Lord. We must follow God's commandments. Hallelujah. If you sin, immediately come back to God. Don't make it a repetitious habit of sinning and coming back and sinning and coming back and sinning and coming back. You then turn to a reprobate mind, having no consciousness of sin at all. Let's read 1 Timothy 4th chapter verses 1 and 2. 1 Timothy 4 chapter verses 1 and 2. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your holy name. Please turn with me in your Bibles to Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter time some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. You see, many people's consciences are seared with a hot iron. This is happening today. We see so much sin and falling away. Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit has explicitly revealed that in the latter times there will be a falling away both from a personal faith in Jesus Christ and from scriptural truth. There will appear within the church ministers who are highly gifted and mightily anointed by God. Some will accomplish great things for God and preach gospel truth effectively, but they will depart from the faith and gradually turn to seducing spirits and false doctrines. Because of their former anointing and zeal for God, they will mislead many. Many believers will fall away from the faith because they will fail to love the truth and resist the sinful trends of the last days. Thus, the distorted gospel of compromising ministers and educators will find little resistance in many churches. The popularity of unbiblical teaching will be primary, the result of Satan's directing his demonic hosts in a more intensified opposition to God's work. The second coming of Christ will be preceded by a greater intensity of Satanism, spiritism, and occult, demon possession, and demonic deception in the world and in the church. The believer's protection against such deception involves utter loyalty to God and his inspired word, and the knowledge that men of great charisma and anointing can be deceived and then deceive others with their mixture of truth and error. They will have a mixture of truth and error as they speak the word of God. This awareness must be accompanied by a true desire within the believer, hearts to do the will of God and to walk in righteousness and fear. Faithful believers must not think that because apostasy is prevalent within Christianity during the last days, that authentic revival cannot occur or evangelism according to the New Testament pattern cannot be successfully done. God has promised that during the last days, he will save all who call upon his name and separate themselves from this perverse generation, and he will pour forth his spirit upon them. Praise God. We give you glory. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Precious Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And then you must turn away from all vain imaginations. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy 10th chapter. Pardon, 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, 3 through 6. 2 Corinthians, 10th chapter, 3 through 6. Let's go there. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, 3 through 6. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Tragically, the church itself will then be overshadowed by the power of darkness, and its families be cast down and taken captive by the forces of this world. Christian warfare involves bringing all of our thoughts into alignment with the will of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And the will of Christ. Failure to do so will lead to immorality and spiritual death. They will use the following four steps to bring your thoughts, life under lordship of Christ. Beware that God knows every thought and that nothing is hidden from him. We will have to account to God for our thoughts as well as our words and deeds. Be aware that the mind is the battleground. Some thoughts originate with us while others come directly from the enemy. To bring every thought into captivity to Christ requires warfare against both our sinful nature and satanic forces. Regarding the latter, steadfastly resist and reject evil and wholesome thoughts. Thoughts in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. We must have wholesome thoughts, not unwholesome thoughts. Remember that we, as believers, overcome our adversary by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testament. Hallelujah. And by persistently saying no to the devil, temptation, and sin. Revelations 12 and 11. Be resolute in focusing your mind on Christ and heavenly things rather than on earthly things. For the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. Fill your mind with God's word and with those things which are noble, excellent, and praiseworthy. At all times, be careful what your eyes see and your ears hear. Resolutely refuse to let your eyes be an instrument of lust or to set any worthless or evil thing before your eyes, whether in books, magazines, pictures, television programs, or in real life. Praise God. We got to keep our minds stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah. See, we keep our minds stayed on Jesus, he would keep us in perfect peace. We do not fight in the flesh. We fight with the power of God. We fight with the power of the Holy Ghost to destroy the strongholds and strong men of the enemy. We destroy every exalted thing, every high thing that raises itself against the knowledge of God. We capture every thought and make it obey Christ. Once one is in disobedience, we must discipline, correct ourselves, and bring back to the obedience of God. Hallelujah. Show them in the scripture what the Spirit says. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is saying regarding their behavior and sinful lifestyle. We must show them, ministers of God. We must show them what the scripture says regarding their behavior and sinful lifestyle. Let the word of God speak for itself. Hallelujah. Making there are many now. They're making the word of God of none effect. Let's go there. St. Mark 7 and 3. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, bless your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. St. Mark 7 and 3. Hallelujah. 7 and 13, pardon. St. Mark 7 and 13. Making the word of God of none effect through your tradition which ye have delivered, and many such like things do ye. You know the words they made, the word of God, none effect. Then they become hypocrites. You see them in the church today, many of them. St. Matthew, 15th chapter. Let's go there. Verses 6 through 9. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. St. Matthew, the 15th chapter, verses 6 through 9. And honor not his father or his mother, and he shall be free. Thus have ye made the commandment of God none effect by your tradition. Ye hypocrites, well did Esaias prophesy of you, saying, this people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. See, their hearts are far from them. But in vain they do worship me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Oh, Jesus. Let's expound on this just a little bit. Some Pharisees invalidated the commandments of God for the sake of their traditions and the ideas of people. Believers today must be on the alert that they do not nullify the word of God because of tradition, popular ideas, or present-day cultural norms. To do so is to fall into the sin of the Pharisees and Jewish leaders. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Turn away from all this craziness. Turn away from it in Jesus' name. Let's go to St. Mark 7 and 8. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. St. Mark 7 and 8. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your holy name, Jesus. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men as the washing of pots and cups, and many other such like things ye do. The tradition of men. The Pharisees and scribes were guilty of placing human tradition above divine revelation. Jesus is not condemning all traditions here, only those which conflict with God's word. Traditions or rules must be based on corresponding truths found in Scripture. 2 Thessalonians 2:15. Read that in your time, please. Churches must resist the tendency to exalt religious traditions, human wisdom, or contemporary customs above the Bible. Scripture is the only infallible rule of faith and practice. It must never be nullified by human ideas. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to read that again. The Pharisees and scribes were guilty of placing human tradition above divine revelation. Jesus is not condemning all traditions here, only those which conflict with God's word. Traditions or rules must be based on the corresponding truths found in the Scripture. 2 Thessalonians 2:15. Churches must resist the tendency to exalt religious traditions, human wisdom, or contemporary customs above the Bible Scripture. It is the only infallible rule of faith, and practice it must never be nullified by human ideas. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians 2:15. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your holy name. Precious Jesus. 2 Thessalonians 2:15. And then we're going to give you a chance to receive salvation if you so desire. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And it reads, therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistles. So only those that are in the word of God are the ones, the traditions that we follow. Praise God. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for the word of God, that it be established in heaven as it is in earth, according to your word, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. Those who desire to receive salvation, please say these words after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I repent of all my sins. I confess my sins to thee, O Lord, to be faithful and just. Forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I believe that you died and rose again for my sins. I receive you, Lord Jesus, into my heart. And now I am saved. Give God glory, give him praise, and give him worship, and give him honor for your salvation. And bless his holy name, because he's worthy to be praised. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Remember, saints, remember all those who are listening. Don't give up. Look up. God is always there. Through the good, through the bad, through the ugly, and in through the indifferent. He's always there. Remember to keep running for Jesus, no matter what. No matter how hard it may become. No matter what may come in your life. Always remember to keep running for Jesus and be encouraged to stay on fire for God and be used all to the glory of God for the work of his kingdom. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Bless your holy name. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the word. If you so desire to contact me, you may do so at IHHJ1 ymail.com. Thank you for listening. May God bless you, and I love you, and take care. Bye-bye.